It's another way of putting it, the old problem of sometimes in order to get an insight, you have to feel good. You have to feel good about yourself, so you go to church. So you do penance, so you do a variety of things to feel good enough to, in order to see. You know, same thing with loving. I mean, who wants to make love unless you feel good? If you feel good, you're also aroused. Aroused is feeling good. So in the same way, if you're having an insight, some significant insight, the likelihood from what I have explored is that the person was able at that moment just before it to drop some fiction about themselves, most fundamental. So therefore they had to sit for long periods of time to get in this state where they could then endure their own insight into themselves. So what's fun is to play meditation games with Plato, speed it up. If that's one of the things that is productive to those insights, then any kind of process that would speed it up, that would be integral to it, would be the most effective tools for meditation. So the ideal thing in a meditation, you see, is to give someone a very clear goal and then watch the struggles they have reaching, especially if it's simple, such as holding on to a very significant question, meaningful question, such as what is the nature of the one? What is the ultimate good? Right now at this very moment, what is it that's seeing, hearing? Is the one and the good the same? Any one of these questions, if you stay with it, you'll surface all of the problems that block you. Because a belief is nothing other than a structure that you've sacrificed for in order to be accepted. So you no longer have to be accepted. It's trauma. It's freedom. But you can't anticipate it, unfortunately. So, if we're running out of time, if you have any more questions, because I'd like to introduce Regina Liliana, who was the person involved in these studies, and Julie Grable, who took the trip to England as well, and Julie Hoygaard, next to her, psychologist, and Barbara also went. And I am sure you can ask them questions that will probably throw a whole different light on this whole movement. What do you think? Do you think we should do that? After you heard enough about it from me, haven't you? Right? Yeah, I have too. So, what do you think? Here's a psychologist, informative in this movement. She started this GGRP. And it hasn't caused her any difficulty personally, of course, in being one of the founders of this movement. What?
I'm crossing all my legs and fingers when I say that.
How do you get paid? I mean, you have to put people, classify people, ESM4, whatever, and HMOs and insurance companies and everything else.
Yeah, that's true.
How do you get paid?
I perform those activities. I follow those rules. But when I'm engaged in the therapeutic session, I practice this method.
Mm-hmm. She's using it in her practice.
It doesn't mean that I can't diagnose the person. And in fact, this helps in diagnosis. Because you're quickly, much more quickly able to see the problems that are blocking their goals and what kinds of ways they defend themselves. So in that sense, it really helps if you want to learn how to diagnose. It will increase the skill.
Again, asking, continue the same kind of question, how about the number of sessions needed to, I mean, HMOs don't care about cures, so let's talk about just to be able to shut the people out of the system again.
Well, it depends on the person's goal. It depends on the severity. Obviously, it's a variable. If you give them the parameters of where, you know, I generally set them out and find out what their goals are, what their issues are, ask them what their goals are, what they would like to achieve, and see whether they're going to be able to achieve it. That is by the way they react to how they respond to working on their goals. And that pretty well determines how long the sessions are going to be. If they're willing to work on their goals, then it's probably shorter. If you see that they're going to procrastinate, they're obviously they're not going to.
I would add to that that people in this game have to state what their goal is. They have to be able to state they have a goal. It's always a specific goal that they are blocked, and therefore there's a disturbance about pursuing it and achieving it. This is a method, therefore, that surfaces the blocks to the achievement of that specific goal. Therefore, it allows people to break through the obstacles to reach specific goals. That's the first level. Then, after they've done that for a few times, then they can take the general goal of wanting to rid themselves of all problems. That's two steps. First step is practical. And I think insurance companies would enjoy that.
And do you give them homework to do? I mean, outside the session, when you say goal,
sure.
Like you were talking about meditating on the major question.
They can be as simple, I work with some of the severe psychotic patients. They can be as simple as just every morning getting up and dressing themselves. I mean, it's getting dressed. And what they go through in the process of following that kind of routine.
Would it be possible to go through case that you handle in chunk it down into some steps so we can see how kind of the steps of is there one that comes to mind that's maybe clear enough and simple enough that would kind of illustrate the model?
Do you think Pierre who has that in many of the, in fact he's done some really
No. Did you see that? I mean, what are we going to do with that? Where do you ask for a case that you're familiar with from your own practice? You don't want to pass it to me.
Okay, but I mean, unfortunately, the kind of cases I work with, the patients are often transferred. So I don't get to sometimes get into the depths I'd like to. But let's take one where, I can remember what he used to say. He comes in and out of the hospital, he's got a high, he's a drug user. He's considered a bipolar, but, we spent the time just focusing on a one scene that he repeatedly brought up that related to what his state of mind when he took drugs. What was the propensity? He was in a good place. He was in an art studio. He loved the work. That was his goal. He wanted to be an artist and pursue architecture maybe in school. This job he had for 2 weeks, and suddenly his brother comes walking through the door, and his brother says, let's go out and get high. Well, this, you're asking a question, what are the stages? This took maybe 2 months to get this out of this person. Like, there's a lot of blockage in these kinds of people sometimes that they can't even talk about specific state of mind at any given time for any depth, like they're jumping around. But in this particular person, he was able to describe this.